Electric cars are quite obviously all the rage these days. You can't move for another EV SUV being launched basically every Tuesday. But do you ever get the feeling that they're not really pushing the boundaries? I mean, if you're being particularly unkind, you might say that the EVs basically look like slightly newer versions of the cars with engines, except they're a bit quieter and cause more panic on the internet. The thing is, an electric drivetrain and electricity is a lot less linear than a mechanical drivetrain. So if you really set your mind to it, you can do properly crazy things. Which is why I think we should meet the Emily GT, because this is a car that might change the way we design vehicles forever. Why? Because this thing has four electric motors, but they're not here.
Or here.
They're not here. Or in here. And that's because they're all in here, in the wheels.
Yep, this car has what's called in-wheel or hub electric motors. And all the control units are stuffed inside there in front of the brake disc. That's literally everything you need, apart from the battery, obviously, packaged up inside an 18-inch wheel. And the results are spectacular. But first, a bit of background, because this car's story is more than a little bit interesting and a bit complicated. Because this is basically the Saab that never was, or hasn't been, yet. It starts with bankrupt Saab being bought by NEVS, National Electric Vehicle Sweden, back in 2012, and then being taken over by Chinese megacorp Evergrande Group in 2019, before running into complicated financial wobbles of its own. Saab engineers and designers, some 350 of them, were all variously left in a kind of limbo. And like all good creative types, they basically decided to make stuff. After a ridiculously short 10 months of gestation, the Emily GT was born. 175 kilowatt hour, 424 brake horsepower, 621 mile range super saloon with nowhere to go, caught in manufacturing limbo. And yes, you could have one with even more power, or a more affordable one with less battery. But this one does 0 to 62 miles an hour in 4.6 seconds, so it's probably quick enough.
It looks pretty good, right? Though you do see some bits of Saab in parts of the styling, especially this big, thick C-pillar that runs into a semi-floating roof with this blacked-out A-pillar here, even though that does make more sense in different colours rather than grey and black. It's a weird car in that it's quite a lot bigger than you think, so it's Tesla Model S Lucid Air type big. And the front is very much an EV face. It's kind of big and swoopy with these swept back headlights that come back into an almost slab-sided body. It's quite a bulky car. The one thing you do notice though, when you look at it, it's got minimum overhangs, maximum wheelbase. Still, I think it's a pretty good looking thing. And inside, it's just as interesting. There's huge space, which is really exciting, and loads of de rigueur 3D printed parts which help with that short gestation period of just 10 months. But everything works. This is a big touchscreen, that works. There's a driver information display and all the controls on the steering wheel work as well. You get the feeling that those Saab engineers compulsively made something that was really very interesting and yet not entirely unproduction. Although this is a prototype, it feels quite real. It's got huge rear seat space, albeit only four seats, but this is basically like a limo.
It's even got a pretty big boot.
And a frunk.
But the best bit about Emily isn't actually the way it looks, it's the way it moves. You see, involved in the project was a company called Protean Electric, headed up by a bloke called Andrew Whitehead.
So Andrew, what exactly is an in-wheel motor?
So Tom, an in-wheel motor is, in our case, a permanent magnet synchronous motor with all the integrated power and control electronics that you need to drive the motor and the software inside a wheel, including all the suspension, brakes, wheel bearing, everything else that you would expect in there. And it lives, as it says, inside the wheel of the car. The larger the wheel, the more power and performance that you can get. We have a product that fits inside an 18-inch wheel, and we're delivering inside that 18-inch wheel 85, 90 kilowatts, which is 110, 120 horsepower, and 1400, 1500 newton meters of torque inside that an 18-inch wheel. The product is power and torque dense. Yeah, it's you're delivering a lot of performance in a relatively small space. We fitted them on commercial vehicles, we fitted them on Land Rovers, we fitted them on vehicles like this, we fitted them on golf-sized vehicles, We've even fit them on a 8-ton military transporter. So yes, they are kind of designed to fit on anything with wheels. You need a battery to power the motors, but the battery in this car is under where we sit, which is the kind of normal position for a battery in an electric vehicle. But also it exists in between the wheels at the front and the rear, because what normally exists there, an electric axle, or EDU as it's called, is now in the wheels where our products are. So there's extra space for the batteries in this vehicle, which is why we can deliver over 1,000 kilometers range. The absolute performance that we're delivering in this vehicle is similar to other electric vehicles. The difference is that the performance has been delivered right there at the wheel. Because the motors in this vehicle are right at the wheel, you can almost instantly deliver whatever you want. So we can define a vehicle that can be as responding as fast as a Formula One racing car, or as slow as you would like your granny's runaround to respond with the software definition and no other changes of any hardware. There are other physical limitations in that there's a suspension system and that controls also how the vehicle feels. Within the limitations of the suspension and the chassis, we can switch this vehicle from being understeering to oversteering to neutral through the software, much more so than you can in other similar vehicles. So we're adding 35 kilograms to the corner of each of these vehicles. You can't just do that and not care about it. So there is some recalibration, retuning of the suspension needed. Typically, in vehicles today, we find there is actually quite a wide range of unsprung masses on general vehicles. And what happens is that you're interested in the ratio of the sprung mass of the vehicle, so that's the stuff above that springs are sitting on, and the unsprung mass, which is anything below the springs between the wheel and the springs. Yeah. And provided that we can keep that ratio within a manageable range, yeah, we can use things like damper settings and tweaking springs and bushes to recover any performance that the vehicle might have lost.
Yeah.
And then you add onto that the really quick control, and you end up with a vehicle that actually should be a higher performing vehicle than the one that you started with. So architecturally in a vehicle, there are a lot of changes that you can make by using this technology, because now you don't have an axle that defines where the wheels go. So you can do things like, you can move the cab forward, which is what vehicle designers talk about, and that gives you a more aerodynamic shape to the vehicle. You don't need to package the batteries completely under the rear seats because there's more space. That allows you to bring the roof line down. Electric vehicles today are very tall, pushes a big hole through the air. And all of these features also add to mass reduction. So more aerodynamic, lighter. The wheel motors also are slightly more efficient because they don't have gears, which take losses. And that all leads to a vehicle that's able to transport a unit of volume in a much more efficient way from A to B, less consumption. So that means less charging, smaller batteries for a given range, lower cost, all these benefits that consumers will reap in the end. What with this technology you're able to deliver is kind of a Mercedes E-Class interior space and comfort and roominess in a Volkswagen Golf footprint.
If I've got an electric motor inside my wheel and it has to drive around, going through potholes and getting covered in mud and water, are they reliable?
The short answer is yes, they have to last because of the industry they work in. But it's not easy. You know, we've been at this game for close to 15 years. And we spent a large part of that learning by breaking things and learning new requirements and new tests, and oh, we hadn't thought about that and that breaks. So we test the motor extensively, and we know the designs that work and we know the designs that don't work. So, you know, just as an example, we have to take a motor that's running at full temperature and dunk it in a meter of ice water 20 times, and it still has to work and function and not work. We come to places like this and we test the motor on vehicles, going over potholes, going through pave, going through mud and slurry. So there's an extensive program of testing, because durability is a hygiene factor, as we say. You have to achieve it, otherwise you don't have a product in this industry.
And as far as it goes, this feels like just a normal electric super saloon. It's fast, so if I put my foot down, it's really quite quick, but there's nothing strange about the way it steers, about the way it goes around a corner, about the way it brakes. It's even got nice regen braking. In fact, The best thing I can say about it is that it feels completely normal. This doesn't feel strange. It's a really good thing.
But the interesting stuff happens when you start to play with it.
So I'm going to go through a slalom now and see how this torque vectoring with the in-wheel motors actually works. There's 65. Wow! Now this is a really big car and you definitely wouldn't think it would go through it. And now I'm actually going to switch it off. So that now is in a setting where the torque vectoring will not work. And I'm going to do exactly the same thing. I'm going to go through this slalom and see what happens. Oh, well, I completely missed the second cone. So there you go. That's it. Not working. That's incredible.
Of course, there are other applications for this stuff. This Defender is fitted with in-wheel motors, and because of the control you can apply, it's absolutely unstoppable off-road. And apparently, because these motors are sealed, there's no worry about submerging them in water or mud or whatever you want to go and drive through. Longevity and durability has already been worked out.
Do you know what? These really work. I did have my suspicions about them, but driving the cars with them actually fitted, they're actually brilliant. You could have three failures and still get home.
The weird thing is, this might seem like very cutting-edge tech, but in-wheel electric motors are not new. In fact, the tech is very, very old. And weirdly, it was invented by Porsche. As in, literally, a 25-year-old Ferdinand Porsche in 1900, well before he incorporated the Porsche car company. The loaner Porsche of 1900 was a front-wheel drive, hub-motored carriage that eliminated the need for all the stuff associated with cars, so there are no belts, gears or transmission. 7 horsepower doesn't sound like much, but in a vehicle with the same dynamic ability as the average Silverline pram, it was probably enough. It was hailed as the epoch-making development, and later Porsche also created the world's first hybrid, the Semper Vivus, which added a gas engine to charge the batteries. But after producing about 300 vehicles, Lohner stopped making in-wheel powered EVs, and the tech has been relegated to special projects like lunar rovers and some mining equipment, until now.
You know what? The Emily GT is actually a weirdly mature bit of design and technology. It's amazing what they came up with in 10 months, because this is a properly good looking car, and those in-wheel motors provide some really exciting possibilities. Is this the kind of future that we're looking at for electric motivation? I don't know, but I'm looking forward to finding out.